All right, can you imagine an egg, a big ostrich egg here? We're spinning it this way. The spin poles on the top and the bottom, and you got the elongation comparable to the equator. Now the equator, because of the centrifugal force, is in the neighborhood of 90 miles greater than this direction. It's called the geoid. Now you can check the real dimensions. It's well known. All right, so you got everything spinning here. Now you change by putting a glob of putty on the globe up here. Put something up there, the centrifugal force, let's say the Wisconsin lobe, 2 miles thick, 1 mile thick, doesn't matter. Big glob of ice in Wisconsin to Michigan. That's going to tend to cause a force like this on the spinning globe, which means the spin axis is going to go over this way. Right? Think about it. So at 90 degrees latitude, the North Pole, the water is much lower than at the equator. Matter of fact, in 1 degree change, you're talking about tremendous. You measure in terms of miles, not feet or centimeters. Instantaneous raise and lower of the sea level. That's transgression. Simple as that. And what this little experiment is going to do is just simply say, you can do it yourself. Do it, and then think about it. Don't look at the equations that the NASA's coming out with. Do it yourself.
Well, the purpose of this little demonstration is to illustrate what people have been talking about as marine transgression caused by a shift in the spin pole of the Earth. Now, it's important because if the spin pole of the Earth shifted by about 2 degrees, when the last big glacial lobe, we call the Wisconsin lobe, was over this part of the country, that creates a tremendous weight or mass, which by simple laws of Newton's motion would mean that there would be a force created because of the centrifugal force. This is the Earth, a little globe, and here's a mass which we'll liken to the Wisconsin globe. If we spin this, there's going to be a centrifugal force outward, which would tend to put a force on the north end of the pole, the north end of the globe, near the pole. This would logically cause a shift. 2 degrees shift would cause Wisconsin to go from, if it's 45 now, to 43 degrees latitude. Because latitude is measured from the spin equator, the co-latitude is from the pole. Now this is extremely significant and important, a factor that we in general have overlooked, and it's hard to imagine that we haven't addressed this over the centuries since Newton pointed out that indeed the Earth should have a greater diameter than the pole, at the equator than the pole, because it's spinning. And that spinning will cause the water to go outward. Now that's a significant amount. You can check any website or encyclopedia. The surveyors use a ratio of about 1/300. You're talking about several miles greater diameter at the equator than at the pole. And the water will follow that. Well, between the equator and the pole is about 90 degrees, or is 90 degrees by definition. So for every degree, you change the latitude in Wisconsin, you're going to cause the water level, in this case, to rise. And that isn't a matter of centimeters. We're talking about a fraction of a mile, or several, or 1.5 miles higher water. Now, that means the sea level would be considerably higher when this glacier was over Wisconsin, along what we now call the St. Lawrence River. Not by a few feet, but more like at least 1,000 feet or 700 feet. And if that happened, then when the glacier started to melt, the water from the St. Lawrence would come in and would cover what is now Lake Superior and Lake Michigan and Lake Huron with salt water. That would be part of the sea. So when the glacier melted, and we can debate when that happened, somewhere between 10,000 to 8,000 years ago, or BC, would be a good approximation, then that weight is off, and you'd expect the pole to go back, and Wisconsin latitude to shift now to about what it is today, 45. If you go up on an egg to a higher latitude, your water will go down by about 1,000 feet, 700 feet, which then puts Lake Superior then above the salt water of the Atlantic, which is where it is today. That's what, to me, the word marine transgression means. But we have pretended that the only change in sea level, or the only change in water level, is because of isostatic rebound. We haven't considered that the pole shift. Now think about that massive glacier, Wisconsin Loeb, how tremendously massive that would be. That would be a horrendous force on the North Pole. Unless we pretend we don't understand about playing on a whirligig, we have to assume there's going to be some shift. 1 to 2 degrees would bring the sea level during the time when the globe was there much higher, so that the water would have been right in Lake Superior from, you know, Lake Superior 600 feet above sea level. 700 foot change in elevation is going to bring the water in to Lake Superior. We aren't the only ones interested in that, because GPS now, the people working with navigation and surveying now, when we are getting coordinates of GPS to near a centimeter, that whole system is based on the North Pole of the Earth. So you've got government agencies like NASA and JPL monitoring very carefully the North Pole of the Earth. And they've got their equations, and none of this is new to them, but it's so complex the common person can't understand from their writings what they're talking about. We want to demonstrate that if we put this globe in water and float it so it's free to go anywhere it wants to, and we add a piece of putty that is similar to the Wisconsin Loeb, that when we spin it, it'll do this. And when we take that off and spin it, it comes back. That's what the whole exercise is about. If people can visualize that, then they can relate to playing on a whirligig, merry-go-round, when they're kids, and you get all the kids off to one side,
they understand what's going on. People understanding Newton's laws of physics can relate as well. Not only is that marine transgression something that's possible, we'd be surprised if it didn't happen when we had this tremendous amount of ice over Wisconsin and northern Canada. So that's what we're going to try to demonstrate. We have a rotating table about the right speed. We can get about the right speed we want. It's not going to be the same as the Earth, but to demonstrate. So we got a piece of paper in to indicate the circles in the center of the table. So if we put a glass bowl on, we can get the glass bowl to turn without wobbling. Put water in here and then put the globe in, and after a while the globe will start to turn. But since it's floating in water, if we add this is simple and can be done at home on the kitchen table, but will take a little bit of skill. So you get the idea? So then Diane helped me get some feathers. And we need to now make sure that once the globe starts to spin, that it is centered. We can push it over, but we need to do it gently. Well, I have to add a little more water, I guess. Just about a half inch. Thank you. Should do it. So, okay, so that should work. Now we should be able to take this weight off, which is a nut held on by putty over Wisconsin, representing the Wisconsin lobe. We'll take it off. Then we'll put a piece of paper over the globe. And from day to day, the globe dries out and stuff. So it's not going to be the same today as tomorrow. So we got to do it for today. And put that piece of paper there, and we'll put a drop of fingernail polish up here on the spot, which is the true spin axis. And mark that. Then we'll put our putty on and do the same thing. And we'll go very slow. Now that first, as you add the weight, what's going to happen, you've got gravity here of the Earth, which you don't have in space. It's going to cause the spin axis to move because of the way it's set up. Then we'll put it on a high spin and mark again. Between the last two points is only due to the spin. And the direction of the shift then will tell us what the direction is on a real Earth. We'll compare that to the work that John Bierman here has found in his research on people doing this in a professional way. But this is to demonstrate to the common person what you can expect, which is parallel to what you kids would expect working on a merry-go-round or a turntable. So now I need to put some paper up there because we're going to be marking the poles, and we don't want to mark the globe. To do then is mark the top, and we'll do that. It'll be a circle of white, and then I'll put an orange in the side of it.
So it shows me that this is about the center. Yeah, okay. We've got a repeatable dot about eighth of a quarter inch in diameter. Right in the middle, we'll put a yellow or orange, I guess. All right, that looks good to me. All right, the center of that orange one is a spin pole. Okay, so that's a spin pole, no weight added. As now, let's say, without any glacier. So the next thing is to add our simulated glacier of the Wisconsin lobe. And that will be right there. The weight has caused the four spin pole to move, which you'd expect. That's the weight of the Earth here. It's not in space. So we'll mark that, and then we'll spin it. The spin pole now with the weight added on Earth, right? So we now spin it due to the weight. We spin it. The difference between those two is only due to the spin, which is parallel to what you'd expect out in open space. Okay, so now we got. This is slow. I'll make sure slow it down real slow. Make sure it just barely turning. Just barely. Checks. Okay, now pull her slowly up to full speed. Now we're increasing the spin. Looking good, go up to maximum. Not abruptly, but no, it's all right. All right. Now the difference between the last mark and this one is only due to the spin. And the direction should be the same as what NASA predict. Definitely different. Okay. Then you turn it off. Okay.
It's a little darker in the center of that one. The green is due to gravity plus spin. Black is gravity only. And this without a weight. So, the lesson is that here's the lobe. The effect of spin moves the spin axis away from the weight. Point is, here is the lobe, and from here to here is the spin. The spin axis moves away from the center of the weight, just as we would expect by looking at Newton's laws of centrifugal force, as kids would expect on a merry-go-round, and as NASA's equations say. So if we understand that, then we can understand what NASA is talking about and other people are talking about when they talk about marine transgressions caused by shift of the spin axis of the Earth. So, as the spin axis caused it moved away from the lobe, the latitude here decreases. In Wisconsin, that would be 45 to 43. Increase the latitude, and we're going to raise the water level by about 1,000 to 700 feet, which is exactly what you need if you're going to get whales and sharks and walruses and seals into Lake Michigan as reported, which is what you need if you want to say that Terry Noble is talking sense and not nonsense. And then when that is taken off, it goes back. The latitude here goes from 43 to 45. The water goes down by 1,000 feet. On the other side, over here, you're going to have the opposite effect. And floods coming in when the glacier melted and never residing, which is what I think you get in the Black Sea. End of demo.